Welcome, everyone. I'm Rick Bennett, and I am the president of Leadership Germantown Alumni Association. And again, we'll take the opportunity to welcome you and thank you for coming out tonight for our LGAA's candidate forum. We are proud to be able to present this forum to you, and hope that it'll be enjoyable and beneficial for all of you, as well as all residents of Germantown, as we learn about the candidates running for municipal school board. So a couple little basic announcements. Please silence your phones if you don't mind, so as not to interrupt the forum. And also, if you are here for court, it is not tonight. Want to let you know, I don't want to disappoint you, but you are in the wrong place, or you're in the right place, you're just here on the wrong day. So we had that happen in the past, so please know you're free to go if you're here to come to court. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Ralph Gabb, and he's going to lead us in our prayer and pledge. Thank you.
Thank you. If you please stand. Bow your heads, please. Lord, we're thankful for this day that you have given us, for its blessings, its opportunities, and its challenges. May we appreciate and use each day that comes to us. We pray for strength and guidance for each day as it comes, for each day's duties, for each day's problems. May we be challenged to give our best always, and may we be assured of your presence with us. Let us remember during this forum to keep the lines of communication open and to be respectful of each other's thoughts and motives. Amen. If you'll please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Russell Johnson will take us from here.
Good evening. Thank you all very much for being here tonight. We're going to get started up in just a minute. The candidates have already received a letter that pretty well laid out the format. But as you can see, we're being televised on Houston HHS TV. And those folks might not be familiar with the format as well as y'all. And I want you to know what's going to be going on in front of you as far as the cards and the volunteers go. So basically, there are approximately five pre-submitted questions each one of the candidates got. They had an opportunity to think about what their answers were going to be, and our moderator will go over that in just a minute with them. They'll start off with the introduction, and then they'll do the pre-submitted questions. We have it all being timed. They've been given 1 to 2 minutes. That is also up to the moderator. He will decide whether the times need to be adjusted according to how the questions are flowing. And the timers will flash cards at them that will give them an indication that there's 1 minute left, 30 seconds left, 10 seconds, and then the red is to stop. And we don't want to embarrass anyone, and it's not intentional to shorten anyone, but when we're out of time, we're out of time. So the moderator's been asked to stop them. And when you see that red sign goes up, they've got a timer up here, and that's why. Also, we're taking questions from the audience. Some of you have been kind enough to email me some questions. We've reduced those to writing. We've passed them up to Mr. Ransom, and hopefully we'll get to those. I'll check with the audience in just a minute. If you would like to ask a question later on after we get started, if you'll raise your hand, we have volunteers that will bring you an index card and a pencil. And then you jot down your question and raise your hand again, and we'll have a volunteer come retrieve it. Now, after they get it, they're going to pass that card over to this table. And all we're doing is we're trying to make sure that there's no duplicity or any kind of inappropriate questions, which I'm sure none of y'all would ask anyway, but it's going through a table. We found that it works well that way. And then they will eventually make their way up to Mr. Ransom, who will ask. We have asked that he give precedent to questions from the audience, so those that are in the binder will be asked eventually, just depending on time. I believe that's about it. If you don't mind, I'd like to recognize a few people in the audience. John Barziza, Alderman, is here. Rocky Yonda, Alderman, is here. Mayor Mike Palazzola just arrived. Ken Hoover, school board, and Juan Emanuel. Oh, and Miss Landers, she's on the board now. Thank you for being here tonight. I don't believe I've missed anyone. Well, we are really pleased to have all the candidates with us here tonight. They've got a lot to share with you as far as their thoughts and visions for the school, so I'm going to turn it over. But before I do that, I would like for you to give a very grand round of applause to the moderator who has agreed to do this. He's an award-winning news journalist, Mr. Richard Ransom.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Really happy to be here tonight. Not only does it get me out of having to do the 5 and 6 o'clock news, which was awesome, but I'm also have a little extra time because we have an NFL game, so who knows when I'm going to go on with the late news, but that's just the way it goes on Thursday nights. So we're excited to be part of this this forum with all of you, and we got lots of questions. It's obviously, I don't know if there's anything more important than educating our kids, so we're anxious to hear your responses. The only thing I would add as far as the rules are concerned is you do have that two-minute window, but it's okay if you don't use it all. We'll just move on to the next question. If you want to respond to something that your opponent or another candidate has said, you have to wait till it's your turn again, and you have that two-minute window, and it has to come from that time, okay? The way that they have established doing this, and I know the candidates are already aware of this, but we're I guess we drew names, and we decided who would be the first to have opening remarks, and so that person will go first. In this case, it's Ms. Meanwell, and then we'll go clockwise around, and then when it comes time for the first question, we'll go to the next person who's seated next to her, and that's Mindy Fisher, and then we'll go clockwise, and then we'll continue to do that for each question after that, including closing remarks. So let's start with the opening remarks. We want to hear from all of you ladies about why you're running, why you think it's important, maybe a little bit of biographical information if you want to share with that. And Laura, we'll start with you.
Thank you. Promoting, don't take that off my time, please. Continue promoting our schools to excellence. I have a strong record of volunteerism in our schools, beginning when our oldest son, who's now a senior at Houston High School, was in kindergarten at Farmington. I've been a room mom, served on PTA boards, chaired book fairs, successfully advocated for healthier and safer start times, and last spring I organized a field trip of to take approximately 45 Germantown students to Nashville to spend a day on Capitol Hill with our legislators. In my church, Germantown United Methodist, I've taught Sunday school, mentored confirmands, and held leadership roles in United Methodist Women. In our community, I've served on three city commissions, library, education, and environmental, and I'm a Germantown Baseball League director. I'm a 2009 graduate of Leadership Germantown and currently serve as the Alumni Association treasurer. I look forward to sharing my vision. Thank you.
Mindy, your turn.
Thank you. And thank you to LGAA for having us tonight. My name is Mindy Fisher, and I'm running for Germantown School Board, Position 5. I have a lifelong commitment to public schools. I'm a graduate of Ridgeway High School and the University of Memphis. Both of my children attend GMSD schools. Over the past 10 years, I have held numerous leadership positions, including PTA President at Germantown Elementary, Germantown Middle, and the Germantown Municipal Council. Currently, I'm serving my third term as chairman of the Germantown Education Commission. Because of this past service and the great opportunities that we have in this district, I bring a unique skill set, knowledge of inner working of the schools, and relationships to get things done. This is not a part-time passion for me, it is full-time dedication.
All right, now your opponent in the race, Amy Oaf. This is an open position, by the way, position 5. Push the red button.
Okay, there it is. Thank you to Leadership Germantown Alumni Association. My name is Amy Oaf, and I'm running for position 5. My husband Edward and I were raised in Germantown and returned here because of the outstanding community and strong schools. My daughter and two sons attend GMSD schools. My passion for education actually comes genetically. I am the daughter and granddaughter of teachers. After graduating from UT Knoxville with a degree of home economics education, I taught 7th and 8th grade family studies in Baltimore County Public Schools. I've been very active in my children's classrooms and in the school's PTAs, including serving as PTA president at Dogwood during the first 2 years of GMSD's existence. During that time, Dogwood grew from a 600-student school to over an 800-student school. As you can imagine, that provided some challenges. I was able to work with administration, teachers, staff, and parents to help make that transition positive. Education is a gift to our students that keep on giving. In our district, we need it to be done not just well, but with excellence, and I'd like to help with that.
All right, thank you, Amy. Next, Suzanne Jones is running for position 3, a challenger to incumbent Natalie Williams. Go ahead, Suzanne.
Thank you. Hello, I am Suzanne Jones, and I'm running for position 3. First, I would like to thank Leadership Germantown Alumni Association for hosting this candidate forum. My family and I are very happy to call Germantown home. I have 3 sons who attend 3 GMSD schools. I also have 20 years of business experience, beginning as a CPA at Price Waterhouse and ending as a senior vice president at Bank of America. 8 years ago, I hit pause on my career and since have been active in PTAs and an advocate in the school administration. During this time, I developed an intense passion for education. I am running for school board because of this passion and believe that my business and team building experience will be invaluable to the board over the next 3 to 5 years, as it will be making decisions that will impact the district and the city for years to come. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Suzanne. And Linda, your opening remark.
Good evening, and thank you to Leadership Germantown Alumni Association for organizing this event. I'm Linda Fisher, and I'm currently chair of your Germantown School Board. My passion for education comes from my mother. She went to a one-room schoolhouse through 8th grade and then went into town for high school, and then she put herself through college. She instilled in my siblings and I the love of education and the love of reading. For the past 15 years, I have served our community as a neighborhood association president, 2-time PTSA president, and 2-time and current president of the Delta Gamma House Corporation Board, where I work with the collegians and the university at University of Memphis. I have served on the Legacy Shelby County PTA, served on the Germantown Education Commission, and I currently serve on the Farm Park Advisory Board and volunteer there for school tours. I've worked in the guidance office at Houston High and been a substitute teacher. While raising our children, I've been a Girl Scout leader and Cub Scout leader. Education is my passion.
All right, thank you, Linda. And finally, we go to Natalie.
Thank you. My name is Natalie Williams, and I currently serve on your Germantown Board of Education in position 3. I have 2 students enrolled in the Germantown schools, and they have been a part of the public schools in Germantown since they were 3 years old. We have been a part of Germantown schools for 7 years. I am an educator. I have a master's degree in education from the University of Georgia. I did my doctoral work and reading specialist certification at Baylor and had 2 years of additional graduate work through Shippensburg University in Pennsylvania. I have been teaching and working with students for over 20 years. The knowledge, expertise, and talent I possess as an educator is something I am proud to give back in service to my community. I have enjoyed my time serving Germantown on the school board, and I am running for re-election because there is still much to do in GMSD, and my experience as an educator will continue to benefit all students as we move forward. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Now we're going to open it up to questions, which is the 2-minute time frame for each response. And we have some pre-submitted questions. I even solicited some questions on Facebook and Twitter tonight. Got one response from as far away as Georgia, but they're Germantown High School alums, so they were, had a couple questions. Not that we'll ask them, but it was interesting to me that the responses came from that far. There seemed to be a lot of interest in how you perceive the board's relationship with the superintendent. You are an elected official, and the superintendent is basically hired by you and the staff as well. What do you see is the appropriate relationship? Do you rubber stamp what the superintendent says? Do you challenge him? If you do, when do you challenge? That's a lot of interest in that particular topic, so we'll just start with you, Mindy, as you have the first answer on that one.
First off, the superintendent is the only employee of the school district. It's our job to set the policy and the vision for the school district. We must ensure that our superintendent implements that vision. It's also our job to be sure that he has provided appropriate feedback, training, and resources to meet and exceed the objectives that his job requires. This includes oversight and direction to ensure that the mission and vision of the school district is met. And that's done through the budget, educational offerings, and the facilities that we manage. There is a level of accountability required, and it will be my job, along with the rest of the board members, to be sure that we hold him accountable. As a school board member, I will work with the superintendent to advocate for the district, the parents, the children of our schools.
Very good, thank you. Amy, you're next.
I'm looking forward to working with Superintendent Manuel, the district office, and my fellow board members. First and foremost, as an elected official, my responsibility is to the citizens of Germantown by focusing on building strong, healthy schools to benefit the entire community. I serve at the will of the people. The role of the board is policymaking, planning, and promoting the district. So we join in a cooperative relationship with the superintendent and district staff working to cast our vision for the future of GMSD. Based on that jointly created vision, the board works with Mr. Manuel to set the best plans and policies in place for our students and teachers, staff, and community. We are the voice of our constituents as we come to the table. We are a body of five people with different opinions and diverse expertise. We need to be able to come together with our superintendent and reach the best conclusion for our students and staff, and that means sometimes we're going to have to work through disagreements while maintaining respect for each other. As elected leaders, we cannot avoid having challenging conversations or asking the hard questions, even of our superintendent, because it is through that process we best serve our children and our schools.
Thank you, Amy. Suzanne, how do you see this relationship as a board member of GMSD with the superintendent and his staff?
The board and the superintendent should truly be a team working together. The superintendent and his staff are critical to the success of our district. As a board, our responsibility is to provide the strategic direction for our district and to create the policies to implement this direction. We need to set bold goals, which will take effort and commitment. We need to ensure that our superintendent and his staff have all of the tools, the training, and the personnel needed to implement these goals. We also need to ensure that our valuable principals, the leaders of our schools, also have the tools and the personnel they need to implement their goals within their schools. Over the next 3 to 5 years, we will be stretching ourselves at the district to reach excellence always. When you set goals which are challenging, difficult decisions need to be made. And with that comes difficult conversations. This is very healthy. It's expected in this type of growth environment. As a board member, I will be an effective communicator, will strive to create flexibility within the board in difficult discussions to ensure that we always put the students first. We need to determine if it is better for the student or just different. As an elected official, my voice will be the community's voice. The superintendent and the board are a team, and at the end of the day, our district's success is reflected in the success of our superintendent and his staff.
Thank you. Linda Fisher, what's your take on this?
Public education exists because we have hopes, ideals, and aspirations for our children. And the community looks to us to educate the children. The school board's role is to set policy, plan, and promote our school district. It's about setting a vision. The city of Germantown started with a vision of having its own school district. And when I was elected in 2013, I had the task with four other board members to create a school district. And I'm very proud of what we've accomplished as we open our door for the third year. As a board, we set policies for our district, and our only employee is the superintendent. He manages the school district based on our policies, and he is responsible for the district and school staff. Boards do not exist to be the superintendent's rubber stamp. The second role is planning and developing a blueprint for our district. This is done through our strategic plan, which focuses on students, teachers, community engagement, and 21st technology. Further planning has been done with our master facilities plan and our capital improvement plan and our 10-year growth plan. I've worked with the district in developing a communication and advocacy plan, which aligns with our strategic plan objectives. This plan sets a timeline to engage our community in key issues coming up with our district. The third responsibility is promotion of our schools and district. As a board, it is vital that we share our mission and plans with the public. It's about taking the board's concerns to the community and the community's concerns to our board. It's about building support for our schools and public education. What makes a good board member? The ability to make difficult decisions, the ability and grace to accept the will of the board, the professional respect for the superintendent and district staff. A saying that sums up a board's role is, boards don't run the schools, they see that they are well run.
Thank you, Linda. Natalie, your turn.
Our role as board members is defined for us through our policy, not necessarily what I always think my role should be. My role as an elected official of the Germantown School Board is characterized by four key responsibilities. Several of the ladies have already mentioned those: policy oversight, fiscal planning, educational planning, and promotion of the district. In terms of policy, it's important that we as a board coordinate with the superintendent and his staff on policy oversight. Our policies must not only reflect state law, but they also have to reflect our community's values and expectations. When it comes to fiscal planning, we have to work hand in hand with our community. The way I've done that is periodically I meet with the PTA presidents at each school and even the Germantown Municipal Council PTA president and find out what are the conversations going on at your school. I meet with the administration at each school and find out what are the priorities, what are the needs, what are the desires. And I work hand in hand with the community to bring those types of things forward to the budget discussion and to board discussion. Educational planning. We have to work together as a team to implement a strategic plan and vision. We've been working on that for the past 18 months. And in that role, again, we have to work together as a community. We had district office groups. We had school level groups. We as a board also met in order to bring that educational plan to life. Finally, we have to support the promotion role of the district. Locally and statewide. We've done that through our senior citizen tour. I've also done that in my position as the legislative liaison to the board in Nashville. Thank you.
All right, and Laura, you get the final word on this one.
As every candidate, or nearly every candidate, has stated, the superintendent is the school board's sole employee for whom they're directly responsible. As such, the board should set clear goals for the superintendent and provide all the resources he needs to effectively and efficiently run the school district. These include, but aren't limited to, approving necessary funding in the form of the district's operating budget and thoroughly discussing any matters he brings to the board for approval. I'd like to talk a little bit about board relationships, however. If I'm not mistaken, the state mandates board relationship training for all board members because it's that important. I attended the school board retreat downtown a few months ago, and my recollection is that overall the superintendent received very high marks on his evaluation, but that board relationship received the lowest score. So how can we and how can the board and the superintendent improve on that? I think we start with a stronger, clearer consensus on the role of the board. This would go a long way towards eliminating friction. The board should clearly define where they want input from one another, and all five board members need a mutual understanding and acceptance of these norms. Secondly, and this is a cornerstone of my platform, I strongly encourage open collaboration and discussion. I try to treat disagreement and conflict as an opportunity to improve on an idea, not as a personal attack. But to really accomplish that, you have to be willing to discuss the topic at hand, and you have to be willing to share your thinking with colleagues. You also have to be a good listener, and having everyone contribute to the discussion is also very helpful for building consensus. I've seen good ideas become great through collaborative effort and discussion. Ultimately, I feel the board and the superintendent must work as a team from a basis of mutual respect, and I have found active listening to be one of the strongest expressions of respect.
All right, Amy, you get first crack at this next question. We're basically just advancing it to the next level in the sense, how do you further see the school board's relationship with City Hall, right here, the Board of Aldermen and the mayor.
Yes. What is good for the city is strong, healthy schools. I see the relationship between the Board of Education and the Board of Mayor and Aldermen as a partnership of working towards a successful school district to foster continued growth in our city. We are fortunate in Germantown to have a very supportive Board of Mayor and Aldermen who have been engaged since the beginning. And through this partnership, we've seen many capital improvements at our schools. My responsibility as a board member would be to continue to foster those cooperative relationships with the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and to accurately communicate the needs of our district in an open and timely manner. I would like to see an expansion of our partnership with the city into promotion of the district. I would love to see the mayor and aldermen at schools and at school events. I would love to promote Storm City Hall events for elementary children, similar to the state level Storm the Hill event. In middle school, wouldn't it be a wonderful experience for them to run the city for the day through a government club or SGA? Also, I would like to see us utilize what the city already has in place to communicate with its citizens to share what's going on inside our schools. What a great way to engage our community outside the school walls than to make sure they're informed of festivals, book fairs, movie nights, and so much more. The larger community can then participate and become active in supporting our schools and our students. Because again, what is good for our city is healthy, strong schools achieved by the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the Board of Education working together for excellence.
Suzanne, your view on the relationship between the school board and City Hall.
Thank you. Within most of the mayor's messages to Germantown regarding the state of the city, our district is usually the first item mentioned. This is because great schools make a great city. Schools are not an island within a city. Building synergies between the district and the city will be key to both of our successes. The mayor and aldermen are critical parts to our district being excellent always. Our city has a long history of high standards, and the mayor and aldermen have the experience of working as a team in a mature structure. Our district is in its infancy stages. Seeking guidance from the city's leadership will be a resource we cannot take for granted. A great working relationship between the school board and the Board of Mayor and Aldermen will be vital to our meeting the goals set out in our strategic plan. As partners together, we are and will continue to blend our district and city in areas such as Parks and Rec, GPAC, the library, and much more. As a school district, the majority of our funding comes from the state and county. These amounts are fairly constant per student, and as a result, any capital expenditures or increases to our budget we deem necessary to create an excellence always district will need to be funded by our city. Our relationship and partnership with the city in large decisions which impact funding will be essential to our district reaching its goals over the next 3 to 5 years. Our relationship with the city will allow us to be able to adapt to changes in funding and school community while not sacrificing our district's goals.
Linda.
The City of Germantown is our funding body and has fully supported our school district from providing office space, IT support and furniture when we first hired a superintendent, to providing crossing guards and school resource officers in our schools. Our board has a working relationship with our mayor and aldermen. Together, we have jointly funded the addition at Riverdale. The city has provided funds to help us with the capital needs for a roof at Dogwood, and they are the funding body as we move forward to build a new school. We also work with the city's Parks and Recreation Department. They have developed the REACH program to provide before and after care in our schools. The program combines educational assistance, recreation, and enrichment activities. Another opportunity to combine resources with our schools is the Bobby Lanier Farm Park. It has a 10-acre education center with opportunities for hands-on activities that tie into our curriculum. Last year, I worked with the farm park to have our Houston High School Future Farmers of America assist with a field trip for our first graders to have hands-on learning activities for National Agriculture Day. As chair, I meet with our superintendent and district staff, with the mayor and his cabinet. These joint meetings allow us to collaborate and find areas that we can work together. One example is the Battle of the Books that was run by our Farmington school librarian. The city library has taken it over and expanded it not only for our community, but county and statewide. Another example is the mayor has interns from our community schools. Another example is the beginning of a working relationship with GPAC to bring artists into our schools and develop a fine arts academy at Houston High. Another example is the developing of a joint wellness clinic for the city and school district employees. This has been an excellent partnership, and I look forward to future collaborations with our city.
All right, Natalie.
Thank you. Just 3 short years ago, there were 5 people sitting in a room, and we were the Germantown School District. And we would not be where we are today without the strong, supportive relationship and the team we have built with the city. And I don't think we thank them enough. They are primarily our funding body. They approve our budget, and they give us additional funds for capital improvements. The only way that we've had 3 successful budget seasons and additional funds for capital improvements is because we have open lines of communication with the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. We have regular retreats between the boards so that we can discuss what our needs are, and that has been very helpful to facilitate 3 successful budget seasons and additional capital projects. When we as a board travel statewide to other Tennessee School Board Association events for our training, we talk with other school boards about the relationship that they have with their funding body. We have a very unique and positive relationship here in Germantown. We are leading the way across the state. When we tell them about the partnerships that we have and the support that we have, other districts are jealous of what we have here in Germantown, and I am proud of the relationship that we have with our Board of Mayor of Aldermen. We have to work closely with all of the commissions. With the addition at Riverdale and potentially building new schools and other improvement projects, we have to go through Design Review Commission, Board of Zoning and Appeals, and we have to have a positive relationship with the aldermen that are liaison to those commissions so that we can know what those expectations are. We've had some amazing partnerships. Ms. Fisher, of course, mentioned the Riverdale expansion. A couple of the other ones that I'm quite proud of are the new turf field and scoreboard at Houston High School. Germantown Municipal TV, which is broadcasting us tonight, was quite an endeavor and an exceptional partnership. And the city also provides school resource officers in all of our schools, which I think is a wonderful partnership as well.
All right, thank you. Position one challenger, Laura Meanwell, you're next.
At the school board work session this past Monday, Mayor Palazzolo made an interesting comment along the lines of the Germantown Board of Education and the Board of Mayor and Aldermen have an unprecedented relationship and that it is quite good. I'd like to see this relationship grow and prosper, but I think we need to recognize that while the city and the school district may have similar goals, they're not exactly the same goals. It's incumbent on the city to address the concerns and meet the needs of the citizens of Germantown, but the school board really needs to take a more granular approach. Because ultimately, it's our children, your children, that need to be the focus of the board's decisions. So this relationship can be a little complicated at times because, as many have mentioned, the school district can't levy taxes or go to the bond market and is dependent on the city for a goodly portion of its funding. Another aspect of the schools and the city's relationship that I'd like to see developed and shepherded is an increasing partnerships between the schools and our city's volunteer commissions. Some have been mentioned already. Part of my platform is concerned with how we meet the needs of our middle majority. These are students who may not be high-performing children, and they also may not require the special programs that exceptional children require. I'd love to see a true mentoring program between our citizens and our students, and I think commission members would be a natural start to such a program. The district could also benefit from a similar structure of volunteer opportunities in the form of district commissions or committees. Another candidate you might hear later has suggested a parent advisory board and a student advisory board. I can envision other groups, perhaps a school sports commission or a public service commission, because not every parent has the availability to serve on a PTA board, so a program like this might provide an avenue to actively engage stakeholders. We might also place student representatives on city commissions such as education, public safety, parks, etc. So I feel there are many ways the school board and the district and the city can leverage those opportunities and continue to grow that relationship.
All right, thank you, Laura. Mindy, you're last.
There's been a wonderful partnership that's been discussed between the district and the city, and I'd like to help continue that. The BMA is our local funding body. They contribute financially to our school district, and we need to be able to successfully advocate for our schools and the children with them. School board members should have an understanding of the long-term city goals. It's important to have the city and the GMSD goals work together. They're not independent, or they are independent, but they can work together so that we can produce high-quality education but keep taxes as low as possible. As a graduate of Leadership Germantown in 2014, I gained a deeper understanding of how the city as a whole functions. This understanding is enhanced by my role as chairman of the Education Commission. I have advocated for all children at all the schools in the city. There should be a balance of free flow of ideas to challenge things to gain better understanding. As we continue working to create a great team, we should be able to candidly discuss all options with our colleagues.
All right, very good. All right, those are the two top pre-submitted questions, and I think that they're important, but I want to get in the weeds a little bit if we can. And Suzanne, this will go to you first. What is your take on getting the 3 G's, the so-called 3 G's back? Do you think that's important? If you do, why? Do you think it's realistic? If you don't, why not? Give us just your overall view when it comes to Germantown Elementary, Germantown Middle School, and Germantown High School. Where would you like to see the board go in that, what direction would you like to see the board go?
I think it is imperative that we get our legacy schools back into our district. There is so much history, there is so much that they bring into our community. The first thing we have to do, though, is we have to get to the negotiating table. We need to work with Shelby County. We need to really understand what they might need. But I do believe that over the next 2 to 3 years, we need to ensure that the schools are back here. We need to determine what it is that it would take. But at the end of the day, we have students in Germantown that are in modular portables. We are building a new school, but if you look at our growth numbers, they are going straight up. And so we will need more buildings. And as Shelby County taxpayers, we have vested interest in schools that have already been built.
Do you think, you have a little time left here, do you think Sure. It's realistic that that can happen?
Absolutely, absolutely. I think when you look at what the benefit could be to Shelby County, I think when you look at what the benefit could be to us, I think we just have to get to the table and we have to get their focus. There are a lot of great people. I actually think that bringing some new faces to the table, I actually have quite a bit of experience in negotiating and bringing teams together and listening, and I think that there's a lot that can be done, and I think it's extremely realistic.
Linda, you next on this one. What is your take? And if we know that the city has tried many times to talk with the Shelby County School Board about the legacy schools, to no avail so far. What makes you think, you know, what's your stance on this? And if you do want to find a way to keep the legacy schools, how on earth is that going to happen?
As a district, in 2014, our superintendent met with Shelby County Schools, and at that time, they weren't interested in having any discussion on obtaining our namesake schools. The following year, upon request for a meeting, Shelby County again said they were not interested. This past year, our mayor has sent a letter offering funds for Germantown Elementary and Germantown Middle, and there have been ongoing discussions between our mayor, our superintendent, our aldermen, and myself with Shelby County School Board members and our county commissioners. And I believe our mayor has moved the dial with his planning and strategies. At this point, though, Shelby County is waiting, as we all know, on the future footprint for their facilities as they right-size the district. In our offer, we've agreed to develop a plan to currently serve those students enrolled and mutually agreed upon transition plan. I know our mayor will continue the necessary discussions to acquire our schools, but we cannot make decisions for our school system based on Shelby County Schools' lack of action. We are over capacity at our elementary schools, and we're very close to being over capacity at our middle school. We are in need of an elementary school, soon, and the next step is to secure community input on land options for a future school.
We're going to get into that in the next round, I think, but we'll let you take, Natalie, the larger question of the three G's and what you think should happen.
Sure. Ms. Fisher touched on several of the steps that we've taken already as a district and in partnership with the city, continual meetings and conversations to find out what this transition might look like. And Shelby County's just not ready to talk yet. And it's very important that we, as a city and as a board, keep that line of communication open and keep positive, strong relationships with Shelby County School Board. We meet with Shelby County School Board members regularly. When we go to Tennessee School Board Association events, we find out what's going on in their district. We celebrate what's going on with them. We talk about our common struggles. And what we found is that we actually have more bringing us together than we do dividing us. We're all in it for the children of this community and this county and to better education. So keeping that relationship strong is important. I know the question says, what is your stance? And I think you have to be very careful once you're on an elected board that the board speaks with one voice. And it's very important that we speak as one voice because we're stronger when we have one voice. And so sometimes your personal opinion may have to be put aside for the betterment of the district or the betterment of the children of the district. I would love to have to acquire our namesake schools. I think it's a priority. If you look at the growth that the facility and growth community forums looked at, the community forums came back to us after looking at the data and they said, we not only want to add on to Riverdale, but we want to add an additional elementary school, and we want Germantown Elementary, Middle, and High School back. That was the feedback from the community. So now we as one board have to take that and advocate for that. I believe that that's our role moving forward.
Very good. Laura.
Thank you, Richard. I cannot disagree with anything that my colleagues have said. I absolutely agree that we need to have those schools back. It's a very important part of our history. The whole south side of Germantown, you know, their hearts were torn out when we lost those three schools. And this indeed is where we turn to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the good work that they do in the negotiating for these properties. I have a citizen did reach out to me recently. She has actually been in the Germantown Elementary and Germantown Middle recently, and there is some chatter you hear about how, oh, those buildings are in bad shape, there's so much deferred maintenance, and yes, there are some things that would need to be repaired, but she assured me they are in excellent condition and would be great assets to our district. So certainly commend all efforts towards moving to reacquire those schools and really getting to the table and finding out what it is that Mr. Hobson is looking for, and I think we can pin that down. We can continue to move that dial.
Okay. Mindy.
This is a subject very near and dear to my heart. Shelby County Schools currently has no interest in selling the schools. We need a willing seller and a willing buyer. Clearly, we're willing buyers, and at this time, they're not willing sellers. As a board member, I will continue to communicate our desire to acquire these schools. I want to continue talking and building the relationships between the two school districts. I bring a history and passion of dedication to GES and GMS. Everyone involved in these discussions need to think about students first and act with integrity and respect. I really feel like we can get these schools back. We just all have to focus on what's right for students.
Amy?
Like Laura, I can't disagree with anything that was said up here. I guess that's the negative of going last. However, I do want to say, as I've walked through the neighborhoods and met people and talked with people, it's become more and more evident to me that it's just not an option. We have to get Germantown Elementary, Germantown Middle, and ultimately Germantown High School back under the guise of GMSD. And I go back to what Suzanne says. It's back to getting them to the table and finding out, okay, what's your button? What do you need? and what can we as GMSD provide, or as the city provide for you, so that we can get these back? And we're looking long term here, okay? The longer that we are without, the longer South Poplar struggles, the longer they are without their neighborhood schools. And that's a problem. Their hearts were ripped out, absolutely. We saw them come in the doors of Dogwood, and our hearts broke for them. So it is near and dear. It is near and dear. And anytime any part of the city suffers, the entire city suffers. So in order to fix this, we got to get them back.
Well, let me follow up with this, and Linda, we'll let you have first crack. Let's just keep this to a minute for the response, because I don't want to dwell on it too much. But, you know, we've done stories interviewing people in the neighborhood of Germantown Middle, Germantown Elementary. They have, many of them, I don't know the percentage, but a vast majority have decided to move to be a part of GMSD.
Yes.
And are first to admit that it wasn't as bad as they expected it was going to be. They are happy with their choice to move their child to a different location, and aren't too excited about having to then move them back again if the city should be successful. What is your response to, I mean, as the more time passes and as people become attached to their new school communities, which we know is happening, how is that a solution if the aside from the fact that it's awfully confusing to real estate agents to have to explain to newcomers, well, yeah, there's schools in Germantown, named Germantown, but they're not part of the Germantown School District. It's a little confusing there. But what, how realistic is that solution?
The majority of our students have moved on to GMSD, but there still is the option for families. They have two options. They can attend the 3Gs, or they can come over to our GMSD school. Most of the families I talk to are thrilled that they have the option to come and attend the GMSD schools. At this time, since we don't know when we'll get those schools back, we need to move ahead and make decisions that best affect our children now and their education. Even if we get the schools back down the road, we need a district office. We're looking at developing a fine arts academy. There's many uses for our schools, and down the road we may need a middle school. So there's a lot of options for the use of those schools.
Okay, Natalie, just a minute or less on your feelings about that.
Two things came to mind. As a board, we did put in place a transfer policy for our Germantown residents. Personally, I felt that was important because it gives the parents and the family the empowerment to place their child in the school that best meets their needs. You may be in the Dogwood zone or the Farmington zone, but feel like the K-8 environment at Riverdale is best for you, or you may feel like the traditional environment at Houston Middle school environment is best for you. So we have that transfer policy. So I would hope that flexibility would remain in place. The second thing that came to mind is anytime you deal with zoning, and we've actually already dealt with this as a board when we were initially formed, it's very important that you have community-wide perspective and that you balance the data that's coming in, the dots on the map, with compassion and keeping our students and our families first and making sure that they are empowered, comfortable, and confident as we move forward.
Laura, your take. You talked earlier about the emotional attachment, which is certainly understandable given the history of those schools. But as time goes on, what are your thoughts?
Well, change is hard, right? They had to experience that once already. But I think the reality is going to be whether we get the 3Gs back or we build a new school, we're going to have to rezone. So it's going to be very necessary that we have change management policies in place and experts to help people move through this. I know we had a town hall meeting before. I would assume we would do a similar format such as that. But again, stakeholder engagement, listening to the concerns of the constituents and the kids and their families, and trying to manage that change as best we can.
Mindy.
I too have received phone calls and concerns from neighbors that now they're like, we've moved our kids. We don't want to go back there. We love where we are. Please don't make us get uprooted. One, I think this is going to be not happen instantly. When we get the schools down the road, we'll be able to look at the current numbers that we've got and all the projections for enrollment and where the growth patterns are in the city. And we can we can come up to develop a compassionate plan to transition the current students from Germantown Elementary and Middle and then include ours. But Laura's right, we are going to have to rezone. But ultimately, all children matter, and we have to care about all the kids, even the ones that are there right now.
Amy, did you want to take a minute and follow up with what we're talking about?
I'll follow up. I mean, ultimately, what we're dealing with is capacity issues. We are now at 900, basically 900 kids at Dogwood, well above optimum capacity. We're well above optimum capacity at Farmington. We're well above optimum capacity at Riverdale. So whether we're dealing with a new school or whether we're dealing with getting GES and GMS back, which is what I hope to do, we're going to be dealing with rezoning. And absolutely, that has to be done compassionately. It has to be done with community involvement. It has to be done understanding that change happens. And we need to recognize that sometimes the decisions that have to be made are made for the good of the whole community, and it may inconvenience individual families. It may inconvenience my family, but I have to be able to make those decisions that are best for the entire community. And capacity is an issue, and it's a now issue that has to be addressed sooner rather than later.
Okay, Suzanne, the final word for you.
Sure, thank you. The question being, would people still want those schools back if they're happy where they are? I think that speaks to our district and how well we've done in transitioning these families. We have done an outstanding job. But what I will say, in having walked neighborhoods and having talked to many people, those are neighborhood legacy schools. And I think everyone would agree that we would want those back. Zoning and rezoning is an issue. In my opinion, as Amy's mentioned, we are already over capacity. In the words of our superintendent, we could fill a school tomorrow with what we have, the number of students we have over capacity. So that's where we are today. It's going to take 2 years to build a school, 2 to 3 years. In that time, we should get those schools back so that we only rezone once. We need to limit the change to these families, and we will already be at that level.
All right. Thank you. All right, so we'll give you the first crack at this one, Natalie. This is a two-minute answer. Let's move on to the topic of the proposal for a new elementary, possibly elementary/middle school. We know that the current site that was recommended has been somewhat controversial. Let me ask you, on a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned are you, concerned are you that the best site was chosen? And if you have doubts, name an alternative site that you think is worth considering that has not risen to be the top choice.
Okay, do you mind repeating that again? I want to make sure I get all the parts.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
It's a two-part question. On a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned are you that the best site was chosen based on what you know about the selection process? And if you have doubts, name an alternative site, or even if you don't, if the decision and the will of the people of Germantown is they don't want the site that is on the has been tabled right now but is under discussion, what do you think would be a good alternative of the ones that have been looked at?
Okay. On a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned am I the best site was chosen based on what we know today? I know that the mayor and his staff, working in conjunction with folks in the community, spent well over a year examining available properties, and some of those kind of came and went. They were for sale and then they weren't, and some things came on the radar later. I don't know that I can assign a number yet, and I'll tell you why. I don't know that we've actually done the due diligence. We actually haven't sent in the architects, the engineers, the experts that know how to look at a piece of property and lay everything out and look at the soil and tell us, is this viable? Is it a solid site? The traffic studies, the access points, all the different things that go into developing that site properly. We have not had a design review group at the school district level to say, this is what we want in our school. These are our dreams. These are our hopes. Is it going to be a K-5 school? Will it be a K-8 school? What type of program offerings? Until we have the community feedback and the feedback from these experts that are paid to investigate a site properly, I don't know that it's really fair to say where in the city is the best place. I think we've got to do a little bit more digging, and I don't want to base a decision just on the limited information that I have now. I think we've got to do a little bit more investigation at this
point.
And
we know there will be some due diligence that going forward here, but Laura, based on what is your initial take on the site and the concerns about it?
Well, I commend the mayor and the alderman and his staff for working so hard to come up with some suggested sites for a new school. But I do firmly believe that we kind of put the cart before the horse. And with something as critical as this, when you're talking about people's children, when you're talking about possibly sending your five-year-old on a bus down to Winchester and Crestwynd, I think you're going to have some pushback. So I think it's imperative that we do have this community engagement that's going to take place on Wednesday, and I really wish that had taken place before the announcement and the decision by the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the subsequent tabling of the motion by the school board last Monday. So let's get through this next step of getting public input, getting those stakeholders heard, and then we can make our assessment from there.
Is there an alternative site that do you think should be considered?
I have not personally driven around and walked and looked at sites. I'm just kind of partial to the Forest Hill and Poplar Pike property. Just it's a nice area. I mean, it just you look at the map and it's like, okay, it's kind of in the center. But
okay. And Mindy, you next here. Obviously, another argument about this particular site is much of it's based on the assumption that we will get those legacy schools and geographically. That's one of the reasons we've heard.
You covered one of my notes.
So, well, good. So just give us your take on the site and its viability and your views on it.
I have to say I've been part of the facility planning committee for the school district. And when we, 2.5 years ago, started talking about all this, that was one of the things is we wanted to look more in the Forest Hill Poplar Pike area so that we weren't going to build right on top of GES and GMS, so that we spread it out and it would be the best location. You know, I was a little surprised when I heard that that's where it was, but as I've been told before, God's not making any more land, so I know in Germantown, so I know there are not a lot of choices. I think that both sites, the one at Forest Hill and the one down at Crestwynd, have challenges. But I do believe in the design process that we can overcome those and we can make both sites really great. I get 2 minutes or
you
one?
You can take more if you want.
Oh, okay. Anyway, I was also going to say I have a degree in interior design, so I have a background in working with plans and how to make things work for the best for the users. And we've got to make a good decision because this is a forever decision. And we also don't want to make it for just this moment. We've got to be looking at where the growth is and what's going on in Germantown and take all of that into consideration with the decision.
Very good. Amy, what's your initial take on the site that's been chosen at this point?
I'm very concerned about it. And I'll echo a little bit about of what Laura said. My concern mostly is the fact that the community heard about this decision on a Friday. There was a vote on a Monday. And here we go. My position is your board, your voice. We need to be hearing from the people way before we're making these kinds of decisions. The South Poplar people are the ones that are most impacted. They should have been talked to. They should have been corralled and said, hey, what do you want from a neighborhood school? Do you want it right next door to Germantown Elementary? Do you want it down on Winchester? Do you want it at Forest Hill and Poplar Pike? Let's look at the options. Let's look at the positive and negatives. Or basic, what are the criteria that you have for the land that you want your school on? That kind of communication has to happen from a community level to the elected officials so that the best decision is reached. And I don't see that that's happened here. Now, I commend the mayor and the Board of Aldermen for the research and the work that they have done. But I, I, I really wish they had reached out to the community first and sought their input before coming to this point. And that's why they're getting the pushback they're getting now. That's why the Board of Education is getting the pushback that they're getting now, because they haven't been involved in the process as much to this point. So as far as an alternative site, I've talked to a lot of people. We've had some different events, and they've had all kinds of opinions. I tend to lean more toward one closer to Germantown Elementary and Germantown Middle, so that it is a walkable neighborhood school for those people in those neighborhoods. And then when we get GES and GMS back, we convert one of those schools to a district office with all kinds of possibilities for an auditorium, a PD room, teacher workroom, and all kinds of things like that.
Wow, this going towards the end is taking all my thunder. What I would say is I'm concerned. I'm concerned not so much about a specific piece of land, but about the process. And yes, stakeholder input should have been gotten, but our board, we are in a Board of Education, should have been involved in determining the criteria. We should have been involved at every stage of looking at this. Absolutely. This goes back to thinking about our relationship with the city. The city has a massive amount of experts that we should be leveraging, but we should be at the table listening and understanding. Now is not the time that our board should be getting educated about this situation. The board should have already had an opinion. They should have already been bringing in stakeholders. So I agree, stakeholder input is really important, but our board needs to be a strong board and a board that takes leadership in certain areas like this, especially when you look at what we have to accomplish over the next 3 to 5 years. If you want to put this in context, Farmington, Riverdale, and Dogwood are all over 40 years old. The decision that we're making about a site for our school will be with us for 40 to 50 years. And we have put ourselves in a position, unfortunately, that we're going to have to get all of our feedback within 30 to 60 days. And that's a lot to get. That's a lot, especially when you have to overcome the emotion that relates to that. So I would say probably between a 2 and a 5, because I'm a numbers person. I have to go throw a number out there. But what I would say is there are other options. But what we should do is not limit ourselves immediately based on a location. There's nothing wrong with a complex of schools. There's nothing wrong with having two elementary schools side by side.
Okay, Linda.
One, we know we have limited land out there available. We know we're at capacity at our schools. We don't believe portables are the answer. And we also believe in neighborhood schools. Our city, which is our funding body, has been looking for land for our schools. As a school board, we voted Monday night to table our decision so that we could attain more answers and that we could have a community forum, a forum where we can share our concerns with the community and where the community can share their concerns with us. Our decisions, as far as which property, really can't even be made yet. We haven't done any site analysis, traffic studies, access points. But I do know this is not a 3 to 4 year decision. This is something that's going to affect us 30 to 40 years down the road.
As a follow-up, Laura, you can first crack at this one. How important do you think it is that an elementary school be a neighborhood school? In other words, that a good proportion of the kids can walk to school, that it's more centrally located. We know that's one of the complaints that you hear a lot about this particular site.
I personally believe that I love neighborhood schools. My kids went to Farmington. We walked and rode our bikes just about every day when the weather was good. And the people in South Germantown lost their neighborhood schools. So I think it's very important to take that into consideration. Now, is it the end all and be all? Is it the deciding factor? No, but I think it does carry some weight in the decision.
Okay. Mindy, what is your take of how important that is? People have said they fear 90% of the kids would have to be bused to this school.
Currently, we live in the neighborhood that's farthest from Houston High School. Well, at least Houston Middle, maybe not Houston High. So my kids endure pretty long bus rides, so I'm very sensitive to that.
I love neighborhood schools. It encourages family interaction. Parents can be there. Kids can go, you know, ride their bike to go play on the playground after school. Unfortunately, there are just not a lot of land choices. And hopefully, whichever land we end up purchasing and building on, that we can make it the most walkable, accessible, bikeable option.
Amy, what's your view on how important it is that this be a neighborhood school when a site is chosen?
I think it's a very high criteria. Now, is it a litmus test for whether or not we should choose it? Absolutely not. I mean, it can't be, because, again, like Mindy said, God's not making any more land in Germantown. However, I do think it should be on the criteria list. I think it would have made the criteria list had we talked to the community before we started looking for land. Again, I speak from someone who has a walkable distance to her school, and that's why I was been able to be as involved as a PTA member in the school that I was in, and it stimulates involvement. It stimulates involvement by the community that surrounds it, not just parents. So if you're looking at, say, the Winchester location, there's just not a lot of community around it to be involved. And I really struggle to see how that can be a walkable or bikeable school. Again, we also do two walk to school days during the year. What are those kids going to do? I don't know. Why do we drop them off at the corner of Houston or of Forest Hill Irene and Winchester and say good luck? I don't think so. So we've got to be mindful of those things, and the fact that if we're wanting a healthy, safe environment for our children, I would rather have a neighborhood school.
Suzanne?
I think a neighborhood school is very important. My view of a neighborhood school is that it's close. There's not everyone who attends, and this was, let's say, prior to our rezoning, not everyone who attends Dogwood or Farmington or Riverdale can walk or bike. We have students who live a distance away that it's not feasible. My view of a neighborhood school is that it's close. It's within the community. So that when you have extracurricular activities, when you say, let's meet at Farmington Park and let's play basketball, people can gather, whether even if it's being dropped off by your parents, if it's being driven there, it doesn't take 15 or 20 minutes to get there. To Mindy's point, the bus rides, the length of time that our kids currently are on a bus is questionable, in my opinion. I think it's a long time, and when you look at a site that's that far away, the bus ride could be a challenge for these children. So, yes, there will be houses that can be built around this new school, potentially, if this is the site, but what I heard was maybe 250 houses. That's not a true neighborhood or a community. It may, at the end of the day, I think we have to be, you know, realistic to there's not a lot of land, a lot of options, but let's do the due diligence with our community. Let's determine what the right answer is, and if it has to be not a true neighborhood school, then that will be a decision that we come together with and have acceptance of. But I do believe that neighborhood schools are very important. It needs to be surrounded by our community on borders.
Linda?
Our school master plan states that we support neighborhood schools. My children attended a school that they rode a bus, and they attended another school in our district that they were walkers. But I do feel that an environment where we are walkers is best for our neighborhoods and our community. I think, again, we can't make any decisions until we look at properties, we look at access sites, we look at infrastructure, we looked at the soil. We need to take all these in consideration before we make any final decisions.
Very good. Natalie.
There's several things I'd like to address with this answer. Is it a 2 minute?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The first thing that I want to ask, I guess the folks that are here and everybody watching, is does location determine involvement? And I say not in Germantown. If you look at Houston High School on a Friday night, or when there's a program, or when there's an open house, you cannot find a place to park. We're parking across the street at Grace Evan. When you go to Riverdale Elementary School and you go to I Love America Day, you can't find a place to park, because it doesn't matter where the parents live in the community, they're at the school. When we have pops in the park, at the municipal park, and you go around and talk to people, and where are you from, and why are you here tonight, or who are you here to see perform, we have people from all over Shelby County that come to our city for our events. So I don't know that location necessarily determines involvement. The Board of Education, with committee work, actually set the criteria 2 years ago, and neighborhood schools was a part of that criteria. The city experts have been a part of the selection process. The superintendent and board members were educated as things learned along the way. The feedback that we're going to get is not 30 days worth of feedback. We're looking at several months of due diligence and feedback with additional community input and retreats with the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. The community forum next week, I hope, will gather concerns and questions that we can pass along to these experts, so that when they do the due diligence, they're addressing our community concerns. How important is it a neighborhood school? I believe that our neighborhood schools are defined not necessarily by walkability or bikeability, while that is important, but I think your neighborhood is the culture that's in your schools, and that's something that we do very well.
All right, next round of questions here. Mindy, you get the first one. We'll take this one from our audience. Do you and or your family members have any conflict of interest to any GMSD members or staff?
Well, I was born and raised here, but none of my family works for the district, so I can't see a conflict of interest in that.
Amy.
I'm with Mindy. I was raised here, but I do not have any family members that work for the district office or staff or in the city.
Suzanne.
There is no conflict. I have no family members or that work for the city or the district.
Very good. Linda.
I have no conflict in the city nor the school district. There are several people with the same last name as Fisher that work in our school district, but they are of no relationship.
Including two up here, right? Okay. Natalie?
No, I don't have any family members here locally.
All right. Laura?
Likewise, no conflict of interest.
Okay. Amy, the next question will come from another audience member. What would you do to improve transparency in school board operations?
I'm trying to get my mic to work. Transparency is a buzzword right now. It really is. It's a hot button issue. For me, one of the biggest and most important parts of being a board member is recognizing that I am an elected official. And it is important to me that I am available to my constituents, and not only available through emails and phone calls, but that my voting record is available, the reasons why I voted the way I did is available, and all of that plays into transparency. The more information that we can put out there for our community members, and the more information that we can gain from them, the better. I would actually like to have a parent advisory committee and a student advisory committee, both to get information from them, but also to share with them what's going on in the minds of our board. I would also like to see some regular town hall meetings, or if we want to do coffee talks. I love to go drink coffee, so come have coffee with your board members and talk in a casual way about what you're seeing in your child's classroom, what you're seeing in your school building, and let us know, hey, what are your needs? What are your priorities? What are your desires and dreams for our school district? And that builds trust, and it builds that relationship, that cooperative relationship that we need. Again, fostering transparency. The more that we can provide communication, the better, the stronger we will be, the more our community trusts us to make the right decision, the better it will be. And all of that comes down to making sure that we are sharing what our hearts are, what our decisions are, where we stand, and why we stand where we stand.
Suzanne.
Transparency is extremely important, and I agree it is a buzzword, but I think what it sums up is that we want inclusion. What we're hearing is including the voice of all stakeholders, from city to the community, people who don't have children in the schools, and then those that are the parents. Since our inception, our board and administration have really been under a great deal of pressure to create this district and make it their own. There have been growing pains and feedback from many, and that's not been easy. Given that our district is new and kind of in what I'll call the infancy stages, we need an extremely strong board. We need to have the leadership that will reach out and grab the feedback. Informal is best. I have three sons that are very active. I'm in three different GMSD schools. And the conversations that I've been able to have since just becoming a candidate have been a wealth of information. And so I think having just that dialogue and it being open and more informal and really looking at having people to have time to respond. Most times what I have found throughout my career and my experience, people just want to have a voice. Everybody wants to make sure they've been heard. And when you can have, one thing that I would suggest to change as far as from a board perspective would be anything that's discussed in a working session should not be voted on at the meeting following. We should have time for people to digest the information and then be able to gather that feedback so that we as board members come in not only with our own view, but we come in with the community's view as well. So I think communication and listening are really the keys to what that would bring us from transparency.
Linda, someone who's on the board right now, you feel like there are improvements to be made when it comes to transparency, or what's your take?
Well, there's always improvements that can be made. As a school district, though, it is about our relationships with the students, the staff, the business leaders, the community members, and the parents. And it's about, again, sharing our concerns and the community sharing their concerns back with us. After our buildings were turned over, we had meetings at each school to answer questions for parents that were coming over to our school district from the 3Gs. We then proceeded with facility and zoning meetings with parents, teachers, and administrators. Next, we had calendar and start times meetings with, again, administrators, teachers, and parents. When making decisions this next year, we've already planned committee meetings as we move ahead with future foreign language programs, analysis of class rankings, transitional experience for our exceptional children. We're going to have meetings again with our parents as we develop a website for our preschool special needs parents. We now have a full-time public relations person who has developed a advocacy plan that contains many ways for us to continue to meet with the community, civics groups, business leaders, and senior citizens, so that we can get that information and take it back to our board.
Natalie, your views on transparency.
When a government's meetings are open to the press and the public, its budgets may be reviewed by anyone, and its laws and decisions are open for discussion, it is seen as transparent. That's just from Google. So I'll start with that. We do have open
meetings. That was quick. Did you just look that up now?
No, I didn't. Okay. I did my homework. Okay. I'm a teacher, remember? So I'm dissect that a little bit. Our meetings are open, obviously, to the press and public, as are our work sessions. Our budgets are online, as are our strategic plan, all of our policies. The videos of our work session and meetings are also available. All of our minutes, our agendas are available online. We have a presence on social media. We, all board members, are accessible by phone and email. I regularly attend events at all five schools and am open to having conversations with parents. What's going on? What's coming? What are our successes? So I feel like it's an ongoing process. It's something that you don't sit still and get complacent with. You look, how can we improve? What could we do differently? Ms. Fisher mentioned we do have a communication advocacy plan put out for the year. I think that's a step in the right direction. But a little over a year ago, I went to the superintendent and I said, we need a communications PR person. We really do. We need to help get the word out. We need to keep folks informed. Let's bring this before the board for discussion. And the board said, yes, this is something that we need. So I'm proud that I advocated for that. I saw the need and made a move for that. In terms of including the voice of all stakeholders, I think we do an amazing job of that. Here's just a few examples of how we've done community engagement over the past 3 years. Three superintendent interview days, the design of Riverdale, a math night at Riverdale, 2 to 3 community conversations with Vanderbilt, zoning meetings, facility plan meetings, 3 growth and capacity meetings.
Very good. Laura?
Well, yes, I believe that transparency is vital to the operation of the school board. And as elected officials, we have to be transparent. That's part of the Sunshine Laws. You can't deliberate in private. So part of transparency is, to me, continuing to videotape the board meetings and the work sessions. And it would be helpful also if all of those were mic'd. I think sometimes it has there's an issue with where the meetings are held. But unless you're sitting, you know, right there like where Terry is, sometimes you can't hear what's going on in a work session. So that's not super transparent. And I don't think it's, you know, intentional, but that's just the reality. I think it's imperative that we continue to do a roll call vote on all of the issues that the board votes on. And I think I completely agree with Suzanne that having a work session where you're really talking about the meat of an issue, you're not best served by then having to make a decision on it in the next hour. I think that just makes it a challenge for I think it makes it challenging for the board members, and I think it makes it challenging for the public to really feel like they understand what the thinking is behind a board member's decision, and that's all part of transparency. And the only other thing I would suggest is perhaps, and this may be in the district's new advocacy plan, I have not seen a copy of it, but perhaps some kind of regular published communication from the board, like a quarterly newsletter or something like that, just saying, here's what the board talked about recently and here's what we're deciding on.
All right, very good. Minnie?
Is it? Okay. I agree, transparency is very important. As the current chairman for the Education Commission, I think that we could apply a similar structure for GMSD. This is a way to get citizen input to guide the board to make the best decisions for students. We would mobilize the community and engage in engagement for GMSD's benefit, and this will help increase communication with our stakeholders. We should have some standing citizen committees. Each committee would have include citizens, parents, students, a board liaison, and a staff liaison. This is a prime example of how the district can harness and engage the talents and resources and experiences of our community. This would allow for a more formalized than just our town hall meetings, which are great, and I'm not saying not to do those, but when something is brought up to the board, like the land, and everybody's wondering, then you can say, well, our financial committees looked at it, our facilities committees looked at it, and so you've had several different citizen groups look at it and give feedback on that. You know, suggested committees could be OPEB, facilities, zoning, technology, textbook, financial, calendars, sports. I mean, there's so many options. And they wouldn't all have to meet monthly. They could meet as needed or quarterly. So right. I think that would really help.
Very good. Suzanne, you get the first one here of this next round. How much direct involvement do you as a board member want in curriculum? And how will you navigate competing agendas, political agendas to be exact, for the good of the students?
As a board member in a very young district, I would think that creating the vision of our curriculum is something that we should be involved in. I envision a common pathway of our curriculum where we look from kindergarten to 12th grade and we see a progression year to year. We also see progression for children who want a different path, than a college track. So I think from a board's perspective, because we are new, because we are young, the board should be very involved in developing the vision for that curriculum. Obviously, our superintendent and his staff are the experts and can drive that and take that to reality and implement that, but I do believe the board needs to be involved in that vision. Thank you. Can you restate the item about the political?
Just how are you going to navigate competing agendas, political agendas, to be more specific, for the good of the students?
We need to be an influence in Nashville. We are currently present in Nashville, but we need to be influencing. We need to work with our legislators. We need to gather a strong voice from our municipality districts, our peer districts. We need to come together and bring a strong voice to Nashville to look and be involved in reducing testing and looking at any potential decreases in funding. We need to be that voice, and I think that's the voice we would bring into our curriculum. As we look at what our curriculum should be, that's what we should take to Nashville to advocate for, not the reverse.
Linda, your vision in terms of direct involvement on curriculum and navigating political agendas in it?
We do have a director of curriculum and a director of special education who provide us with a lot of information as far as curriculum. We do make decisions on curriculum with parent committees and teachers. We also, as far as textbooks, we have parents come in and help us make decisions on the textbooks. There are a lot of things we can add to our curriculum. We started out just opening our doors. Now's the time when we can start moving ahead and making some changes and adding some new things. Before serving on the school board, I was a member of our Career Technology Education Advisory Board. We currently offer computer science, STEM, finance, criminal justice, health and biomedical science, and several other CTE programs in our schools. We need to emphasize, though, that we need to work pathways for our CTE students to aspire to pursue other options other than four-year degrees. We need to look at work-based learning, where during seventh period, students can go out and have meaningful internships with our businesses in our community. Our vision should include TCAT, where dual credit can be received for technology. I was also involved in the initial committee for a grant from Vanderbilt called Community Conversations to increase meaningful employment opportunities for individuals with intellectual and cognitive disabilities. We formed a partnership with Baptist Hospital and GMSD, where students will have work-based learning opportunities one day a week. I see my time's shortening. As far as legislative, we are very involved. We work with our state school board association, we work with other school board associations, and we have a close working relationship with our legislators. This past year, we started a legislative breakfast where we brought all the municipalities together and all our legislators to talk about the topics that were going to be coming up on the Hill that year, and we'll be continuing that this year.
Natalie.
How much direct involvement as a board member do I have with curriculum? There's several different pieces there. When new courses come before us or new courses become available, we have to approve those courses, and those courses have to have state approval as well. So that's something that we have a role in. We also are involved with funding the supplies and approving the textbooks that go along with the curriculum. In terms of all of those pieces, I feel like they need to be in line with our strategic plan and vision. If we're wanting increased service and internship opportunities for our students, if we're wanting additional career tech offerings for our students, if we want to celebrate all pathways, for example, we need to make sure that what's coming before us for funding approval and coursework approval are in line with that strategic plan and vision. One example, we've asked that that we continue to be the highest ACT score in the state. We've done that for 2 years in a row, and we'd like to continue doing that. And in response to that, the staff has put together ACT prep skinny periods at the high school. So they took over the curriculum and the implementation of it after we gave them that direction. What they're doing there actually goes all the way down to third grade. It's called an Aspire Suite. And what we've learned from this is actually something that we can take to Nashville. And we are working very closely with our friends in Lakeland and Arlington and Bartlett and Collierville to take this initiative to Nashville. We actually had this discussion Tuesday night when we were all together. As the legislative liaison for the board the past 3 years, I feel that we have a very strong voice in Nashville. We make regular trips to Nashville. We have regular meetings with our legislators. We are very influential in Nashville. We're very well respected in Nashville. When we did our board self-evaluation, legislative advocacy was our strongest measure, and my leadership there is something I'm very proud of.
Laura.
Thank you, Richard. One of the things I'm very concerned about is ensuring meaningful opportunities for every learner. And I did talk about this a little bit earlier, about this middle majority, this cohort of kids that we may not be meeting their needs as well as we can be. So I do think that there is a role for the board to play in that, in sort of nurturing that as a goal. I was glad to hear Linda talk about some of the plans moving forward, because I think these mentorships that I have mentioned several times would also work towards having internships and work-study programs. I think that's very appropriate. I know that before we implemented the math curriculum, which has gone over really well, there was a textbook committee that got together and really vetted that. And I think where we slipped up is in that we did not properly prepare our teachers and our schools for that curriculum. And we had to backstep a little bit and have some math nights and kind of got caught up with that. But in regards to the board being involved with curriculum, those are the types of things that I could see the board doing. I'm not entirely sure what this political agenda question was targeting. I'm thinking that it may have been more of a local level. I don't know, and I'm sure you don't exactly know.
I have different theories, but I don't know that we've really addressed exactly.
So I'm going to take a little bit different approach, and I'm going to say that, goodness gracious, children should always be at the focus of the board, and there should not be any competing political agendas when it comes to our children.
Well, first off, we have to follow state law, and whether we like it or not, but we can work a way to use the curriculum that we are bound to use, but in a way that really helps our kids. But that doesn't mean that we can't work to change that. Like Natalie said, I think that the district has a very good relationship with Nashville. I know that the Tennessee School Board has, our Department of Education has had regional meetings that cyclically, when they look at each one. And I know this spring, the PTA presidents from GMSD were invited to go to the one on English language arts, and I think it was math, and give feedback. So I think, and the crazy thing was, we were the only ones from Shelby. There was one parent from Shelby County Schools. So we just need to be sure that we're getting our representation there at those chances too, because that's when they're really looking for the feedback and open-minded about what changes are our districts looking for. And I know that they had parent meetings and they had teacher meetings and did them in different regions. We just need to be sure that we are adequately represented at those also.
Amy.
I think I'm going to go back to the original question on the textbook, the role of the board in the textbook curriculum selection. I'm agreeing with Natalie. She's, the new courses, the funding, approving the textbook. But ultimately, it's the big picture of goal setting. What is our goal? I feel like I would like our end goal to be that every child that graduates from Houston High School graduates college and career ready, college or career ready, whatever they choose. And so we work backwards from that being the end goal. That's our goal, to have a graduate that's college or career ready. What do we need to provide for them all the way back down to kindergarten. Where do we start? That's where the building blocks are. We have educational experts in our superintendent and his staff that help us vet curricula. And we also include parents in that involvement. And we include teachers. And that's important. And I think we as a board need to trust that the superintendent and his staff knows their stuff. However, we need to make sure that we've prepared our teachers. I go back to what Laura said. The math curriculum is one. I think there's some similar frustrations with the English, the language arts curriculum that's coming out now in the elementary schools, that materials aren't in on time, that they didn't have all the books when they needed them. We need to make sure we have our supplies in on time. And that's stuff that I think the board needs to come back and say, okay, where was the breakdown here? And let's address it so it doesn't happen in the future. Let's provide for our teachers so they know what's coming. And let's do it months in advance so that they're not trying to plan over the weekend on new material that they just got the week before. And I speak as a former teacher. That's not fun. So it's that larger goal setting. How do we reach the larger goal and the big picture? That's the board's job.
All right, very good. 2 minutes time, six candidates. It goes very quickly. There are a lot of questions I want to try to get in here, and time is rapidly disappearing. Let's try and leave these answers to a minute if we can, and hopefully they're not too involved like curriculum questions are, and you can handle them in a minute or less. There's lots of interest in bus service. Why don't you just give us, each of you, your view on whether it needs to be status quo? Is it worth the extra money we're paying for the different start times? Are you okay with start times staying where they are? Do we need to go back to the times that existed before this school year? Linda, you get that first. Buses and start times.
This year, we changed our start times, and I want to commend our district staff. They worked very hard during the first 2 weeks of school. With a 45-minute turnaround time, we couldn't get the buses from Houston High to Riverdale. The students were showing up 15 to 30 minutes late. The district worked very hard to reroute the buses. We also now let the students at Houston High leave 8 minutes early that are bus riders so that we can get the buses out the door and across town. And they worked very hard on this. As far as what we're going to do in the future, I think we need to, again, get feedback from our community and see how they feel about it. I think that early start times are good for our children. I think we also are going to need to look at what the total cost is going to be this year.
Okay, very good. Natalie, your take on bus service as it stands now and start times.
Okay. My family does use bus service. My boys ride the bus every day to school and home, and we've been very pleased with the bus service so far. But status quo is not acceptable. The superintendent's heard me say this. We're going to be paying $1.5 million for service, and it does not look like it, and that is not acceptable. So we need to take a closer look at transportation, go in a different direction, but we're going to need some input on that, financial input, community input, maybe even talk with folks that specialize in routing and efficiency and that type of thing, and move forward providing the best service that we can for our children and our families.
Laura.
Near and dear to my heart, of course, because I did work very hard to advocate for healthier and safer start times. And I beg your pardon, Linda, but I could not disagree more that earlier start times are better for our kids. I do acknowledge that we have had a lot of difficulties with the transportation issues. And I feel like we have this expertise in our community. I mean, FedEx is right around the corner. So I believe with some community input, and we really put our minds together and discuss this, we can come up with optimized routing. We probably do need to look at a different provider. That's something that the board would probably want to start looking at now. Like, what are we going to do when that contract with Durham expires?
Mindy.
I think everyone agreed that we wanted to change the start times. Starting at 7 is not what I would think was our best choice. However, I think the timing was wrong. I think we should have waited until the contract with Durham was over, and we weren't going to be paying penalties to Collierville when we have so much deferred maintenance and the money that it's cost us this year to run extra bus lines and the with the penalty and all, I think that's money that we could have tucked away and started to seed if we want to go into our own transportation business. You know, there's a whole lot that goes into having our own buses. We'd have to hire, you know, 25 to 30 more employees, and it's going to take about a year and a half to figure that out. So there are a lot of options, but I think Laura's right. Right now is the time that we need to start looking at the future of transportation for GMSD.
I'll agree with Mindy and Laura. These are decisions that we need to start looking at now. We need to start getting community involvement. I also very much like start times being later. My children are impacted, currently two of my children, and I am thankful for the extra hour that they get of sleep. It has made a difference in our household, and I know so many people have come up to me and said the same thing. However, in terms of buses, I would really like for us to explore having our own bus fleet. I think we have the potential with FedEx being nearby, doing our possibly helping with us doing logistics. We were able to successfully incorporate an ambulance service in Germantown, and it is doing very well. I think we can tap into the city's knowledge base in that. And just to throw this out there, you know, would police and firemen who are off duty maybe be willing to drive our buses? Who knows our streets better? And get a little extra pay on their off days.
All right, Suzanne.
Start times. We made a decision last year, and I think that's where we stay. We, as a district, get community input, we make a decision, and then I think given where we are, especially in the decisions we have to make, we need to move forward and not look back. We did struggle with buses, and I will commend the superintendent and his staff for the communication and for the care and for the concern of what they had to go through as well, because they felt every bus being late, not just the parents and the children. This is a prime example of where we need a strong board who can look at options. We need to be looking at what are our options for busing. Is it new busing? Is it, to Natalie's point, holding Durham accountable for a $1.5 million contract? But those are the decisions that we as a board should be looking at, and again, today. But do an analysis, lay it out, look at the dollars, and make sure that we're including the city, because a lot of this legwork has probably been done.
Okay, thank you, Suzanne. Natalie, let me ask you about drugs. There's some concern about that, obviously, especially at the high school level and middle school level. Do you feel enough is being done in terms of the allocation of school resource officers to deal with which is becoming a concern nationally, and that is the growth of opioid addictions, painkillers, which lots of kids have access to their parents' medicine cabinets and can sell the stuff. We know it happens. Do you think enough is being done to address that potential problem? It actually is a problem in many areas right now.
It's interesting that this question came up. I was out walking neighborhoods, knocking on doors, meeting our registered voters, and had a quite lengthy conversation with folks whose student had left Houston High School several years ago about this very topic. And it was really interesting to hear their perspective. My children are still in elementary school. We haven't reached the high school yet. I have been a high school teacher in the past, so I am aware of the presence of those types of products in our schools, not just here, but nationwide. I don't think we're ever doing enough. I think we always need to take a closer look. What can we do in terms of education, in terms of outreach, again, partnering with the city to talk with our students, I think is definitely something that we could put a priority on.
Laura?
I completely agree. I do have high schoolers. They are not using. And they don't run around with kids who do, but I do realize it is a problem. And again, I believe this is something where we leverage our partnership with the city, and whether it's more counselors, more accountability to, you do hear rumors about this athletic group or that group smoking pot in the locker room. I don't know if that's true, but I think we definitely should look into it, because this is where you need to stop and make sure that we are taking care of these kids.
Mindy.
Well, the city's done a great job of putting SROs in each of the schools, which is school resource officers. Okay. And it's great that they're there because they build up rapport with the children, and I think they're going to have a better idea of what's going on in the school, and they're more approachable if a student has an issue that they want to share. Yes, there's always room for improvement in that, and I believe the district's put another social worker at the high school, which I think can help with some of that. I think there's some great programs that we could have for the parents. I actually heard the district attorney give a really good program on this very subject, and I'd love to have her come and speak to our parents. But, you know, we all just have to stay vigilant because you can't say it's not my kid.
Amy?
It's not, though.
Yeah. Don't start my time yet. Okay. I agree with Mindy. This is every parent's worst nightmare. Part of what I taught when I taught family studies was drug education, and that was in seventh grade. These kids are being introduced, and that was in the late 90s. So these kids are being introduced to things that we cannot even dream of at earlier and earlier times, and we need to be aware of that and not blind to that. The joke at my school when I was growing up was private schools just get the better drugs simply because they had more money. And that's pitiful, but that's where we are. And so we need to make sure that we are mindful that our kids know what's out there, know the consequences of the choices that they're making, and then we have resources for them if they make those poor choices. I would say, as a parent, I have a friend, Brad Reardon, who works in pharmaceuticals, and he actually would like to talk with us about possibly partnering with the municipality and providing drug testing for parents, not for the schools, but for parents for free for their children if they are in the municipality.
Suzanne.
Thank you. As my colleagues have said, this is an issue, and it's not just for us, but it's nationwide, and it is something that we cannot overlook. But I'll also echo the sentiment that it is a team working together. It takes parents, it takes the city, it takes our district, and it takes the teachers, the guidance counselors, the social workers in our schools. The one area that I've noticed as I've been looking at, you know, numbers, employees, our guidance counselors have a very heavy load of students, some as high as 400. It is hard to keep a handle on 400 kids and if there's a little bit of a change in their behavior, and that's the first line of defense. So I would say that we could do more as a board to help our superintendent look at ways to incur to change that scope. So yeah. I think we need more.
Very good. Final word.
This is an ongoing issue in our community and nationally. We have at the high school, we have a Shelby County officer, and we have a Germantown school resource officer. They are involved in the students' activities. They are out in the halls. They really have a pulse on what is going on in our schools. But again, we do need to be concerned. We can add additional classes to PE. And I also feel like our social worker is there in our schools for children who are having problems. Again, our guidance counselors really are more to guide our students academically, and we have a full-time social worker who deals with students who are in need of some guidance if they have illness in their family, they're being bullied. So she also is one, too, that works with students.
Thanks for helping out with the time here, because I'm going to get one more question in. There's a lot of questions about the future of the district, and I know that can be a broad question, but more specifically, they bring up the issue of the new $100 million school that's going up in Collierville, and even though all the suburbs were joined in force when it came to separating from Shelby County Schools, now it's a competition, is how many people see it. Real quick, minute or less, do you think that I'm going to keep it simple. Do you feel that the Germantown School District is doing enough to compete with the other suburban districts and private schools, too, for that matter? Laura, you get this first.
I think that what Germantown is going to need to do is find its niche. What are we the best at? And that is something that the board, and with input from the community and the superintendent and his staff, will determine. What will make Germantown the best? How do we define that? And then you set your goals and you work towards that. You lay out your plan and your strategy to work towards being the best. And I don't know if that's being the fine arts mecca of Shelby County, if it is blowing out all the stops on STEM and STEAM classes. I don't know what that is. That is something that we as a community would need to determine. But that's how I think we stay competitive and how we determine that we are the best in the county and in the state.
Mindy.
The mission of GMSD is stated to prepare, inspire, and empower students to become lifelong learners and socially responsible citizens. I think that that goal, and if we keep working towards that, we have a wonderful product. And clearly, because we need to build, and we're talking about after the elementary school's built, that we're going to have to build something else or get the other schools. So I think that one of the things with GMSD is our high school is amazing. And I think, you know, there may be some families in Collierville that are like, I don't want my kid lost in a mega high school. So I think having a right-sized high school that offers so many amazing things, like Leadership Academy, Fine Arts Academy, which I'm personally excited about that coming, and an Honors Academy. So I think there are a lot of wonderful things that we're doing.
Amy.
I agree with Mindy in that we wouldn't be having the capacity issues that we had if we weren't providing an outstanding product. However, we can't get complacent in our success, because complacency, we start to backslide. So we need to be looking toward the future, and the board's goal should be 5, 10, 15 years down the road. What do we want to be 5, 10, 15 years down the road? And I would like to say that we would be the premier district in Shelby County and hopefully even in the Mid-South by 5 years down from the road from now. And I think we need to be putting growth plans in place based on what our community input is, based on the population that we're bringing in and what their strengths are. My other goal would be, I would like all levels of our learners to be college or career ready when they graduate from Houston High School. And the fact that we are addressing all levels of learners will be attractive to all kinds of families instead of just those on either end.
We are a premier city, and because of that, we have the advantage of not only we have a great school system, but we also have a great city, and what a great package. And I think that will always help differentiate us. What we can also look at, and I know that this is the path that we've already started down, but we as a board need to ensure we give our team that the tools, is to look at the whole child. We need to ensure that whether it's Fine Arts Academy, whether it's the Honors Academy, whether it's a vocational opportunity, or whether it's STEAM, we have something that children can be well-rounded and leave school ready for their career or ready for college. Again, very challenging from a perspective of we have a lot to do in a short amount of time. And so having a team of a board and a superintendent that can work closely together to accomplish this is key.
All right, Linda.
Our mission statement is, as a school district, to prepare, inspire, and empower our students to become lifelong learners and socially responsible students. I want all students to be successful and career ready. Success can vary for our students. Recently, our Commissioner of Education, Candace McQueen, said that success can be in a 4-year degree, a 2-year associate degree, a technical certification, or maybe a job in the community for individuals with intellectual disabilities. I have a special needs sister, Kathy, and when she finished high school, she had the opportunity to have a job. That was her success. Let's instill in our students the beliefs that they are capable of academic excellence and possess the potential to be his or her best. They can do this through our Honors Academy, our Leadership Academy, our CTE classes, or creating jobs for our learning disability students.
Most important is the future of our children and to create successful schools that will showcase the value our community places.
Natalie.
I'm going to tweak your question just a little bit. Is GMSD striving to compete with other municipalities and private schools? And I say that we are striving. Are we there? No. Are we continuing to work? Yes. How are we doing that? As a teacher myself, I know the biggest impact we can make on a child's life is making sure that we have an outstanding teacher at the front of every single classroom. And we do. We have hundreds of people that apply for one position. Our hire rate is 8%. Our recruitment and retention of excellent teachers has won awards across the state. Our students at graduation earned over $32 million in scholarships. When they said, if you have a scholarship, please stand, almost every single graduate stood. We are competitive, and I am so proud of the work that our teachers and students have accomplished thus far.
Very good. Thank you, ladies. Now it's time for closing remarks. Mindy, you get to go first. 1 minute, please.
One minute.
Is there two? All right, go.
We prepare three.
3 minutes? I guess I missed that part.
And bye, golly.
Okay. Well, if they're prepared, that's difficult to do, I understand. But I want to make sure everybody gets in. I've never heard of 3 minutes of closing remarks.
Well, believe me, we worked hard on it.
Everybody say three? All right. Okay. Go for it.
I'll try to go fast. How's that?
Read fast.
Thank you again to LGAA and to Richard for hosting us tonight. I have a passion to move our district forward. It's important that we demonstrate values, beliefs, and attitudes that inspire others to higher levels of performance. In preparation to become a school board member, I have met with each of the Germantown Municipal School District cabinet members. This was to ensure my understanding of their roles, current issues, and the organizational structure. I will prepare myself on the issues that come before the board and impact the school district. As a school board member, decisions will be made with consideration to current and future academic needs of Germantown. GMSD is fortunate to have highly qualified teachers, administrators, and employees. We want to employ compassionate, committed, student-centered people. The hard work on every level adds to the incredible education experience of our students. As a school board member, I want to continue to inspire new learning opportunities at all levels. There must be ample opportunities for professional development. Inspiring a teacher will in turn inspire students. During my leadership roles within Germantown and the community, I formed strong working relationships with the City of Germantown and local elected officials. I'm the founding president of the Germantown PTA Council. This allowed me to work closely with the district office staff, the principals, and the staff at all five schools. With these experiences in the schools, the district, the city, and community, I can help continue and strengthen the partnerships between GMSD, the city, Germantown, parents, and citizens to reach our goals. As a member of the Germantown Municipal School Board, I will thank students first. All means all. I will act with integrity. I will treat all board members with respect. I will support and promote the school district in an ethical and productive manner. I will turn reflection into action. Vision into reality. I will work hard for students, families, employees, and citizens. Simply, I want to ensure the best education for our students. I want to be part of the meaningful discussion for all involved. As your next school board member, I want all of us to educate, engage, and inspire the next generation of citizens. Germantown elections are about grassroots and community. I humbly ask for your vote. Thank you.
Amy.
I would like to thank each of you for spending this evening learning about your candidates for school board. This is your board and your voice. I have so enjoyed meeting and talking with many of you. Your passion and desire for excellence in your schools is evident, and it motivates me to work harder for your children. So let me share a little bit of my vision for GMSD, for the future of our kids. The four C's to working together for excellence. Clarity. I support establishing a clear vision of excellence for our district with the end result in mind. We can only achieve the goals we set. I support transparent, diverse, and open leadership. I want to hear from my fellow board members, the superintendent, and my constituents as we set policy and plan. You will know why I voted the way I did and how I voted. I support conservative fiscal stewardship of taxpayers' money. Collaboration. I support stakeholder involvement with the creation of parent advisory board and a student advisory board. I support strong, meaningful negotiations with Shelby County to get our three namesake schools in GMSD where they belong. I support the separation of work sessions and board meetings to different days to allow ample time for discussion, deliberation, and decision making. I support engaging the community in our schools through increasing internships and work studies involving retirees with tutoring and guest teaching and utilizing local business support. Communication. I support the creation of a district-wide master calendar available to all citizens. I support quarterly town hall meetings or coffee talks for the school board to hear what is on the hearts and minds of their community. I support communication with parents regarding the timing and results of any assessments given to students. Creativity. I support providing our teachers and staff with the tools, the training, and the time they need to create the best learning environments for their students. I support taking a fresh look at how RTI is implemented in our district so that all of our students are positively impacted and our teachers' strengths are utilized. I support educating the whole child, first by reducing standardized testing to the state minimum, and second, by broadening opportunities for students in subjects outside of tested areas. I feel fortunate to raise my children in Germantown, not far from where I grew up. My passion for education, my love for my community, my experiences as a teacher, PTA leader, church leader, and parent create a unique perspective that would be a strong addition to the Germantown Board of Education. I want to work together with you and be your voice at the table. I humbly ask for your vote this November 8th.
Thank you, Amy. Suzanne.
First, I have to give a shout out to my boys who are watching at home. Your mom has almost survived her first TV experience, so thank you. Our district has a $50 million budget and has 500 employees. We are one of the area's largest businesses around Germantown and Memphis. Our board should have a voice which has a financial and business background. And I am the only candidate with this background and one that has addressed critical issues on a large scale. Building trust and a strong relationship with all parties involved will also define the success. My keys to excellence always in a district are strong teacher retention and recruitment. We are well on our way, but we will be hiring a significant amount of teachers as we continue to grow. And we want to continue to be leaders, so we want to be strong in that area. Class size matters. My opponent stated in a budget work session in April that, quote, once you hit third grade and beyond, the size of the class does not impact academic performance, end quote. I strongly disagree with this message. We as a district should establish our own class size criteria based on teacher, parent, community, and other successful districts' input. We must build trust through community involvement. When our board, administration, and community work together, great things can be accomplished. As a board member, I will promise to have composed,
and focused conversations at all times, and work to ensure that all voices are heard, and most importantly, that time is allowed for the review of significant decisions. Influence in Nashville is vital, as I've stated before. We need to ensure that we have the strong voice there and that we push for real change for our district where we feel we need it. Working toward these keys to excellence is what I will bring to the board. My financial and business background, as well as my ability to build a collaborative environment which brings people together, is what our board needs over the next 3 to 5 years. In closing, I would like to say that I would appreciate the opportunity to work toward these keys to excellence as a board member and would like to have a seat at the negotiation table to bring back our legacy Germantown schools. Thank you to everyone for your time tonight, and I ask for your vote in November for position 3 to ensure excellence always for our district. Thank you.
All right, Linda.
Before I begin, I do want to clarify, when I talked about start times and community input, I wasn't referring to the community getting together and changing start times. I was about the community getting together to make decisions about our buses so we can get our schools to our children to school on time. And whether that's we don't contract out anymore or we have our own bus service, that's what I was referring to. In 2013, 5 people were elected to the Germantown School Board. We had no money, no policies, and no staff, and the task of opening up a new school district. It wasn't easy, but in 6 months, over 500 teachers were hired, over 200 policies were passed, health insurance, transportation, maintenance, IT, all were put into place, and we opened our doors. As a board, we have continued to make tough decisions to educate our children. As we opened our doors for the third year, we have over an $8 million reserve. We have a $1.7 million health insurance fund and a fully funded OPEB. We were named one of the top 12 exemplary schools in the state of Tennessee, and we have the highest ACT score in the state. My role as a parent, PTA volunteer, PTSA president, past legacy Shelby County school employee, and school board member have given me the experience and the unique perspective to make decisions for all of our children. We are blessed in Germantown. We have engaged students, involved parents, and qualified teachers that guide our students from pre-K through 12th grade. The next few years are key in moving our district ahead, moving us ahead academically, supporting and training our teachers, and updating our facilities while maintaining fiscal responsibility. Do you want someone with the knowledge and experience that can make this happen as we go forward? I'm currently the chair of the school board, and I humbly ask for your vote on November 8th to continue serving our community.
Thank you, Linda. Natalie.
Germantown Alumni Association. As a graduate, I realize that we are a working and service group to this community, and I appreciate the efforts of everyone to put together the event tonight. Before I start my closing statement, I would like to address my opponent's statement about class sizes. The statement that I made in a work session is not my stance, and it is not my position. I was quoting a research study in the effort to bring a different point of view to the board, which is what a work session is for, to look at multiple points of view and have an open mind before we make a decision and move forward. I love Germantown. I love our schools, and my commitment to the schools and this community is not defined by the 3 months leading up to this election. My commitment to public education began in the fall of 1994 when I started my Master's of Education program at the University of Georgia, and continues today with my work on the Germantown Board of Education. I have spent over 20 years investing in students, not financial markets. My commitment to all students in all 5 schools has been evident in my actions and participation at events at all the schools over the past 6 years. My service to our community is evident in my service at the Bobby Lanier Farm Park, GPAC, and service on the Education Commission. We are climbing the mountain called Excellence Always. We look back and see how far we have come. We certainly have more to go. If you were to climb Mount Everest or Mount Kilimanjaro with a team of people, who would you want to be your guide? Someone who has been climbing that mountain for years,
or someone who has just started their training. My opponent mentioned several times tonight that we have a lot of big decisions ahead, and I could not agree more. Over the past 3 years, I have been a part of making several crucial big decisions, one being opening our doors. Making these big decisions and my record is what got us here, where we are today. So looking forward, who do you trust to make future big decisions? I humbly ask for your vote on November 8th. I have thoroughly enjoyed serving this community and putting my talents as an educator to work. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Natalie. Laura.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Leadership Germantown Alumni Association, and for all of you here and at home. We moved to Germantown from High Point in East Memphis about 13 years ago when our boys were 2 and 4, so we could raise them in a loving, safe community, and so they could go to great public schools. As I mentioned in my introduction, our boys have gone all the way through Farmington, Houston Middle, and are now a sophomore and a senior at Houston High. They couldn't join me here tonight because they're both in the Houston band and had rehearsal today, and they better be doing their homework. My sons have transitioned from county schools to unified schools to municipal schools and have ridden the bumps with great fortitude, as many of your children have done. I've seen firsthand as a parent what this transition has been like. We are at an exciting time in our city, in our district's growth, not only in sheer numbers, but in philosophy and in vision casting. The past 2.5 years have been extraordinary, and I commend the sitting board and Mr. Manuel and his staff. They have accomplished a great deal in a short time. But the foundation that we lay in the next 3 to 5 years will be the basis from which our district prospers. Now that we have the doors open, we begin the challenging task of promoting to excellence. I have an engineering degree, and I love to problem solve. Bring me a challenge, I will roll up my sleeves and get to work. I've always taught my children, if you think something needs improvement, be a part of the solution. The cornerstones of my platform, providing quality resources for our kids and teachers, ensuring meaningful opportunities for every learner, engaging all stakeholders in bettering the district, and fostering open collaboration and exchange of ideas are the solution. That is promoting to excellence. We need to transition our board from being reactive to proactive. For example, as we discussed earlier, our transportation contract is going to end after one more year. A proactive board will ask our superintendent to begin exploring options and ideas now, well in advance of having to make a decision on a new contract. That is promoting to excellence. A proactive board seeks public input before even considering to proceed with selecting a parcel of land on which to build a new school. That is promoting to excellence. A proactive board gets ahead of the issues and is transparent in their decision-making. They are tapped into the concerns of their constituents and communicate and ask for feedback in advance. Communication should come through official channels. Parents don't want to find out about issues that impact their children on social media discussion boards. I've been married to my best friend for 19 years. He's right there in the audience. It didn't take me long to realize that as close as we are and as much as we may think alike, he cannot read my mind. So I don't think that we can over-communicate. That is promoting to excellence. I have a vision for our district. I want to be part of the solution to bring our schools to excellence always and beyond. And with your support, I can be. I humbly ask for your vote for position 1 on the Germantown Board of Education. Thank you, and God bless.
Very good. And so that is our forum for tonight. A round of applause for all the candidates. And all of you for coming. It says a lot about education in Germantown that so many people did attend and watching at home as well. And let's just hope the debate and forum on Monday is just as civil with the presidential candidates. I don't think we'll get so lucky. Don't tell me there's another debate. I'm sorry about the misunderstanding about the closing remarks, but everybody got their full 3 minutes in, and we appreciate you all being here tonight. Thanks for having me.
Just about 30 seconds, if you don't mind. I just want to recognize, if you will, the volunteers who are out here, the timekeepers. That's quite a tedious task. Our co-chair, Ralph Gabb, our president, Rick Bennett, and the other volunteers, Yuki with the photographs, if you would recognize them. Thank you to HHS TV for televising this event. And, you know, we all know very many reasons we are blessed to be in this community, and I think we've just seen 6 of them right now. These candidates are just all wonderful choices. You recognize them again, if you would. And of course, events like this don't take place unless you've got a really strong voice that's going to lead you through the whole event. And Richard Ransom's done a wonderful job. Thank you all for being here tonight, and we'll see you on November 8th.